Yes, well, hello again, everyone. I'm just going to put the speaker down so you don't get an echo. Welcome to the next program of WeLearn. Today is going to be a little bit different from the other ones, as that it doesn't really focus on an animal or a group of animals, but it's actually focusing on some part of technology. But that technology is often used, again, to help in conservation or to work with animals, so that's the link there. And so the other link is that also we have just started with the introduction of our GPS following the Jika on the map, which also is just the beginning for what Wild Earth wants to do with it. So I thought it might be an interesting idea just to show you a little bit of what is possible with GPS, what kind of things can be done with it, and also how it is used at the moment to actually to make distribution maps for certain species of animals and in conservation. So I've collected a couple of links. I couldn't find all the links that I thought were there, but that's the thing with the internet. Sometimes links are there in 2006, and by the time you look for them in 2008, then they've been gone or put in a different position or just no longer available anymore. So, but I think I've got a couple of interesting ones for you. But before we start with that, as always, the answer to last week's viewer challenge question. Last week, one of the things we had was a centipede. And my question for the viewers was, what is the largest living centipede at the moment? And actually, the answer to that is, I think a lot of people got it right. Most people that sent in a question, actually, they did get it right. It's the Amazonian giant centipede, and it lives in caves in Central America. And the size of it, it goes up to 30 centimeters of 1 foot. So that is one big centipede, and because it is so big, it also needs bigger prey animals, and actually one of its main prey animals is bats. Bats that lives in caves, and the bats live in the caves as well. And the way it hunts the bats is actually quite fascinating. It walks and it actually goes upside down on the ceiling, and then it lets the front part of its body dangle free and actually plucks the bat out of midair and then catches it and eats it. It's actually quite fascinating. The first time I saw that, the footage of that, I was blown away. I never thought anything like that existed, so that was quite interesting. On that topic, if you actually want to see footage of that, there are some videos of YouTube that actually show that behavior and the bat or the centipede actually catching the bat. The best way to find it, because there's so many videos on YouTube, is if you go to YouTube and you type in the search, you type in giant bat eating centipede, then a couple of videos will show up, and one of them has the behavior I just described in it, and it's definitely worth going there and having a look, because it's something you, if you didn't hear about it specifically or thing, then you wouldn't think about it. You always think about centipedes of not quite big, but definitely not foot long and be able to catch mammals in that case. So that was the answer to last week's viewer challenge question. I just actually realized I didn't think of one for this episode yet. So actually during the time I'm presenting this, if you see me thinking a little bit of frowning, then I'm probably trying to think of a question while I'm actually presenting this. But yeah, back to GPS. A lot of you will have seen that we've started using GPS position for the Jika. And just to show you how that is set up, we have a GPS receiver on the vehicle itself, and the signal that it receives, that GPS receiver receives signals from satellites that are up in the sky. I think it's about 20,000 kilometers high, and there are either 31 or 32 satellites circling the globe, all in different paths. Some go north-south, others go east-west, others go a little bit in between, and the whole combination of all these orbits of the satellites is set up that at any time, at any place on the world, or almost any place, there will be enough satellites directly visible above you in the sky, or maybe quite low, but in line of sight, that that you can determine your position with that. And determining the position with that, I'm not going to go into the real technical things, but basically what you can imagine, if with the speed of light, of the speed of signals, all these satellites, they send out time codes, just very precise with atomic clocks at time. And then the first one that actually is received by your transmitter actually synchronizes the time between the transmitter and the very precise satellite time. And then the second one, as you can imagine, that from the satellite, the signal goes out basically on a, what do you call it, on a sphere. It goes out in all directions. And if you know the speed of light, after 1 second from the satellite, you know that the signal is, the time signal is about 300,000 kilometers from there. So let's say if you receive a time code that is, let me say, 1/10 of a second off, that is 1/10 of a second time 300,000 kilometers, then you know that you are 30,000 kilometers away from that satellite on basically a globe that is in all directions 30,000 kilometers away from there. Now that doesn't really help you, because you can still be anywhere on the sphere of that globe, but there's a second one. And the same thing with there, you get a little difference in time between the reception of those two satellites, and you know the distance to that one as well. And then what you have to be, you're also on the sphere of that globe, basically that limits your position to actually a circle that actually intersects those two globes. It's a bit what you can compare if you have two bubbles of foam. You've got two bubbles, as soon as they come together, it's not exactly the same, but just like an analogy, on that, let's say on the area that they touch, there's a little, almost like a line, a circle that goes around it. So if you have two satellite signals, then you know that you're somewhere on that circle, and then you get a third one in there, and that intersects with there as well. So if you get a number of satellites, then you can actually zoom into your position more and more and more. If you get a good signal, and at good times you can get 12 satellites, and that allows you actually then to pinpoint your position to typically within less than 5 meters, or sometimes even with the new satellite, new GPS receivers, much better than that even. And yeah, because of that, and as with many of these technologies, GPS technology is actually originally a military technology. The network of satellites that we use has been launched by the US military originally, and originally also they use it, of course, for their own warfare purposes, but for public it was a bit scrambled, so you couldn't pinpoint your position in less than 100 meters. But I think somewhere in the mid 80s, or I'm not sure about the time, they switched the scrambling off, so that now since then everybody has the accurate signal available and can determine their position within typically say within a radius of 5 meters. There's always a chance that, you know, if there's a big war coming or anything, that they can always switch that scrambling back on. But I don't think that's likely to happen. If it does happen, then there's a lot of people going to be in trouble. Imagine all those people that now have the navigation systems in their cars and all that other things. If suddenly the accuracy of that would go back down to just 100 meters, then that would create havoc, I think. Because we start so much relying on technology after a time and just accepting it for granted. But as much as I want to say about the technical part, because if you're not an engineer, I guess it's not that exciting. But let's go to some applications of it. And let me start by Google Earth. Actually, I should have zoomed out earlier. But Google Earth is basically a program that has satellite maps of the whole surface of the Earth in it. Let me just zoom out further. See the whole... just now switch to the map so you can actually see it. Up, there it is. So you see you've got the whole Earth, and the whole surface of the Earth is mapped by satellites again with pictures. And Google Earth is using those pictures. It doesn't have very accurate pictures of all the ocean, but all the land masses are very accurately depicted. You can see there's Africa, Europe, there's the US here. Here are the ice masses on Greenland. At the bottom here you've got Antarctica, very, very, very large. What I want to show you is also, because if you project a map on a flat surface, then it distorts already. But just have a look. If I just put Africa at the center here, just it takes a huge part of this side. Now if I put Europe there, you just see how much bigger Africa is to Europe, for example. On maps, because it's at the high latitude, actually it... Europe is expanded, it gets pulled apart to make it wider, but if you just see about the true size, if you fly from Cape Town, for instance, to Holland, which I do sometimes, it's an 11-hour flight. This distance here, all the way over Africa, takes about 8.5 hours, and then you got another 2.5 hours here just over Europe. It's just it's amazing. But yeah, so everything is photographed here. Anything that is